All right, tonight I want to talk about the subject of should we follow men or God? You say, well, we should follow God, of course. Well, yeah, I know that, but there's a thing that goes around when you get into this Bible-believing movement. When you start to repeat certain things, you will be told, well, you're following a man. I only follow God. I follow Christ and Christ alone, and I only read the Bible and nothing else and whatever else. And the funny part about that is, 9 times out of 10, in fact, you could almost make it 10 times out of 10, the person that says that is actually following a man, telling you not to follow one. The idea there being that once you get saved, you should just simply read the Bible and don't listen to any preachers or anything. I've never advocated that. I do believe in the priesthood of the believer. I do believe that you need to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. I do believe that he can show you many things. But to say that you should never learn from older men, that's a problem. And if you're a sister out there, there are older women in the faith that can teach you things too. Okay? But let's start out. We're going to look at a couple of scriptures here that people will turn you to. And clock is chiming. A good reminder that there's not much time left, before we go to be with the Lord. Just a constant thing there to hear. Time is ticking away. It's 9 o'clock in the evening as I'm beginning this. Very busy day. James chapter 1, verse 5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. Okay, where does your wisdom come from? It comes from God. Ultimately, all wisdom has to come from God. That's why it doesn't matter how many books you have, God is still the final authority, and his word. Sanctify them through thy truth, thy word is truth. John 17, 17. One of our memory verses here at King James Video Ministries. You need to know that one. But your wisdom comes from God. Remember that. 1 John chapter 2. Verse 27. It says here, but the anointing which ye have received of him abideth in you, and ye need not that any man teach you. But as the same anointing teacheth you of all things, and is truth, and is no lie, and even as it hath taught you, ye shall abide in him. Again, when you get right down to it, you don't really need any man to teach you. I mean, if you are in a foreign country and you are saved, like in a very strong Islamic country, which I guess, if the Vatican gets their way, every country is eventually going to be Islamic with their mixing and integration and everything. But the fact of the matter is, you don't really have any need that a man teach you. You say, then we should just scrap any preachers and teachers out there, right? No, that's not what the Bible teaches. And to teach that would be to misapply this verse here. All right? Very important to remember that. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20. Been wanting to put something together on this thing for a while because I get this a lot, who do I recommend and whatever else. Well, we'll be getting into that in this study. 2 Peter chapter 1, actually we'll start at verse 19. We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. Reference to Jesus Christ there. Verse 20, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Now, again, somebody could use this thing wrongly to say, well, no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation, therefore you shouldn't listen to men, because the Bible says you have no need that, you need not that any man teach you, and if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God. So therefore, if you're quoting things from Schofield or any other teacher, Peter Ruckman or whoever, well, then you're wrong. Then you're in the wrong. You're being taught by a man. You're following a man and stuff like this. And you should only follow the Lord and only have him as your ruler and things like that. Yeah, but then wouldn't you be getting into the same problem? as far as no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation, if you only listen to yourself and nobody else. See the problem it gets into? But now, are we to follow men? Let's look at that. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. And this is becoming a very, very big issue. That's why I put this sermon together. Lord, have me put this thing together. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, we'll start at verse 15. For though ye have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet have ye not many fathers. For in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel. When you lead somebody to the Lord, you are effectively now their older brother, so to speak, kind of like a father. Now, you're not to take the title father. The Lord Jesus said that we're not to call any man on earth father, as in the title, a religious title. Obviously, that does not mean, you know, your birth father. It's perfectly fine to call him father. Because why? Well, because the Bible says, honor thy father and mother. So it's perfectly fine to say, you know, and, you know, Isaac says to Abraham, father, you know, the Lord doesn't rebuke him for that. So it's okay to call your birth father, father, and it's okay to call your heavenly father, father, but not a religious title. That's not what's going on there. But look at verse 16. Paul says, I've begotten you through the gospel. Verse 16, wherefore I beseech you, be ye followers of me. A true Christian will follow Paul, and through Paul, the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to see that as we continue. But you will see aspects of Paul's ministry in your own life. You'll see it there. We'll talk about that here in just a little bit. Next, we're going to go to chapter 11, 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 1. It says here, be followers of me, even as I also am of Christ. You know, again, you'll get this thing. You'll get a lot of people, they'll try to say, well, I follow Jesus Christ. I follow Christ alone. Christ, you know, he's the one I follow. We should only follow Christ. Well, that depends on who's saying it. You see, because there's a whole organization that follows Christ. I won't mention any names because I don't want to be hateful or bigoted or anything like that, judgmental. You know, yeah, it's called the Catholic Church, right? I'm being a little sarcastic there. Catholicism teaches that the Pope is Christ. They also teach that every priest is Christ. He's another Christ. So you get some Catholic coming out and saying, yeah, I only follow Christ. I don't follow men. I only follow Christ. Well, they're actually speaking in a veiled sort of way. Because to them, Christ is any number of different things. It's a cookie that you eat every time you go to Mass, the Eucharist. It's the priest, and it's also the Pope. Christ's church, you know, the organization as well. So watch out for that. If they're truly, when you are a Bible-believing Christian, you will follow specifically what Paul wrote to us as Christians. Paul is the apostle of the Gentiles. And even if you're a Jewish Christian, even if you're a saved Jew, you're still going to follow what Paul wrote down in the Pauline epistles. That's very important to remember. Philippians 3:17. Let me just mark a page here quick. Philippians 3:17. We'll go there next. We'll see another passage about following. Went a little bit too far. Philippians 3 and verse 17. Brethren, be followers together of me, and mark them which walk, so as ye have us for an ensample. All right? So in other words, it's, yes, we're supposed to follow Paul, and through Paul, we're following Christ, because, you know, it's interesting, because when Paul is there, he's Saul, you know, and he's blind, and, you know, the Lord basically says about, you know, go show Paul what great things he's going to have to suffer for my name's sake. You know, and Paul basically went through a lot of the same things that Jesus Christ went through. So Paul, in his life, he did follow Jesus Christ. He followed the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's a very interesting study you can do sometime. Look at the sufferings that Paul went through and look at the sufferings that Jesus went through. Very much the same. So, interesting. But notice here in this verse, verse 17, mark them which walk so as ye have us for an example. You know, there are certain Christian preachers down through the years that their ministries have been Pauline ministries. In other words, they have followed Paul. And, you know, I will just tell you a little testimony of my own, and that is when I got into ministry years and years ago, I was very unsure, and I thought to myself, well, I feel a calling from the Lord, you know, into the ministry, and this might sound kind of weird if you haven't heard this before, but I'll just share a little bit of my testimony. I actually started into ministry so that I could fail. So what? I actually made my first video and I just kind of put it out and I thought, well, you know, it's not going to go anywhere. It's not going to do anything. The Lord's not going to use it. So then I can get rid of this calling that I feel to go into ministry and I can go back to my secular job. I enjoyed working my secular job. I was a logger slash wood turner, carver, you know, and things. It was a great job. A lot less stressful than this job, the work of serving the Lord like this full time. A lot less stressful, but a lot less rewarding too. But, you know, I went into ministry and I thought, okay, Lord, if this is what you want for me, okay. You know, just show me one way or the other. And I was a single guy when I went in and I had people harping on me for that. You know, you should be married. Well, the Lord brought a wife along and they said, okay, you should have children. Well, Lord brought a son along. You're probably going to be able to hear him in here. He's in here in the other room playing, you know. So the Lord has been confirming that he is behind this ministry. And the main reason, or the main way he's been doing that, is by making me go through a lot of what Paul went through. And, you know, I've learned things from men who have gone through a lot of the things that Paul went through. A lot of these books that I have here, and I've read a lot of these, you know, some of them are just for documentation, but I studied for a long time before I went into the ministry. And a lot of these guys have gone through a lot of things that Paul went through, which we'll be discussing in a little bit, you know. And so what do? Well, you mark them that walk in the footsteps of Paul, following Paul. You mark them that walk so that you have them for an example. You see? That's what you do. So should you say, you know, I just follow Christ, I don't listen to men and stuff like that. That's not what the Bible teaches. We just read about it there in Philippians 4, verse 7. Wait a second, did I get that right? Excuse me, 3:17. Philippians 3:17. We just read about it. You are to mark them which walk, so you have them as an example. Follow Paul, his example, and thereby follow Christ. That's true, but you are to mark other great men of God. And there's a lot of them down through the centuries. Next, let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 2. See, I don't know. I still think we should just, you know, just us and the Lord, you know, nothing else, nothing getting in between there. Well, there's some scriptures you're going to have to get around. Here's another one. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Extremely important verse. One of the most important verses in all the Pauline epistles. You are supposed to learn from many witnesses. Now, I'll grant you that's a little tough right now because there aren't too many that are reading and preaching from the King James Bible. And of those that are, there are a lot less that actually believe it. And of those that do believe the King James Bible, there's even those, you know, less of those that who are actually sound in their doctrine. You know, so it's tough to have many witnesses now. But the point is there, what we learn, the way that the body of Christ is supposed to perpetuate itself and move out and spread out, is the things that we learn among many witnesses, again, reading, studying, you know, those things you commit to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Who is Paul writing to here? He's writing to Timothy, and he calls him my son, but Paul was never married. So he's not his physical son. He's his spiritual son. And what he's saying is, hey, you've learned this from me, you've learned it from brother so-and-so, you learned it from brother in there, and brother, 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 brother. Now that you've learned these things, commit those same things to faithful men so that they can teach them also. And see, it perpetuates that way. We don't have some repository of the truth with the Holy Mother Church where everybody comes to and they're told what to believe by a special selected priesthood that's told what to believe, you know, and whatever else. And the doctrines are there until the Pope or some other, you know, person comes out and says, this is official new doctrine or something like this. And many of the Catholic doctrines, like the Assumption of Mary, you know, was basically in the 1950s. It was made official doctrine. So the Immaculate Conception, late 1800s. So a lot of this stuff, Vatican II changed a whole lot of things in the 1960s. So the Vatican, oh, we are the standards of the truth. We stand by the truth. You study the whole thing, and we're not going to get into it here, but you study it. The popes contradict each other down through the centuries. Back in John Wycliffe's day, there was two different popes fighting against each other. John Wycliffe is calling them both antichrists and stuff. I mean, the Catholic Church contradicts the Church Fathers, and the Church Fathers contradict the Scriptures, and it's a whole rotten mess, that whole Catholic system. And the Greek Orthodox system is not far behind it. Okay, at least they had the right Scriptures. They didn't use the Alexandrian Egyptian Bible, but, you know, they used the right text, the received text, but they still have all their unbiblical traditions, you know, still working their way to heaven. But the thing that's so important that I want to get through in this study is, while I do believe that the Lord can show you what you should know, you also have a responsibility to learn from men that are walking in the footsteps of Paul. Now, I don't teach an unbroken line of apostolic succession down through. I believe that it was there, but to actually prove it is going to be very difficult because a lot of Christians down through the centuries just did not write things down. You know, and if they did, their writings were collected and burned by the Catholics. So, you know, I mean, you can go back through and do the history, and there are early Christian groups that predate the Vatican, predate the Protestant Reformation. Those groups are there, certainly. But, you know, you say, well, what all were their doctrines and their teachings and everything else? Where can I get the books from them? Those books aren't there, okay? But a book is here that teaches us true doctrine. And that's really all you need. I mean, the King James Bible right here is the very best translation that ever showed up on the planet. And all you need to debunk Catholicism is this book, the Holy Scriptures. But let's continue. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. You say, well, but I don't understand. I mean... Do you stand for everything that Peter Ruckman stands for? I get that thing all the time. Like, I guess I'm his, you know, devoted disciple or something like this, and he's my cult leader, and I never question him. No, I don't believe in every... I wouldn't agree with Ruckman in every single point, but if you want to know the greatest Bible teacher of the 20th and going into the 21st centuries, if you really want to learn a lot of Scripture and a lot of things, Ruckman's your man. He knows the Bible a lot better than I do. And I thank the Lord for him. I thank the Lord for the stands that he has taken. And, you know, I know a lot of guys that are graduates of PBI, Pensacola Bible Institute, the little institute down there. It's not a university. It's not even a college or anything. It's just an institute for teaching young men the Bible. And I know a lot of graduates of PBI, and they all have different ways of interpreting things. You know, I know graduates of PBI that are into the house church movement. I know graduates of PBI that are going to the Babel buildings. I know graduates of PBI that believe the gap theory. I know ones that don't believe the gap theory. I mean, I know a lot of PBI graduates. I've had contact with them over the years, and they're not coming out just programmed robots from Peter Ruckman. You know, and I know a lot of you have written in your comments about, you know, how you've been blessed greatly by watching Peter Ruckman's studies and things. Great. Praise the Lord. Another good one, another graduate of PBI actually, is Sam Gipp. Sam Gipp's got some real good stuff. Absolutely. There's some other guys. James Knox, I think he has some good stuff. Charles Lawson. I mean, there's a couple guys that I think are good, sound teachers and things. I disagree with them on different issues. Absolutely. We have that ability as Christians. I mean, Paul and Barnabas, and at one point in the book of Acts, I don't have the scripture here, we're not going to go to it, but at one point in the book of Acts, they had a contention that was so sharp between them that they departed. You say, what was it over? You know, major doctrine? No, it was about whether or not to take Mark with them. Paul said no, Barnabas said yes. And the contention was so sharp. Big disagreement. Major disagreement. I've had some disagreements with some of the brethren, Brother Greg Miller. I had a big disagreement with him a while back, but you know what? You know, again, in spite of whatever issues you want to make about the guy, he's still straight on the Bible. He's still straight in his attacks on the Roman Catholic system. He's still pre-trib. Hey, praise the Lord. Great. Other guys, you know, again, you know, I don't want people thinking that I just am out here just blasting people, you know, right and left. If I don't like them, if I don't agree with them, the first time I hear them, just boom, they're gone. No, I'll give a guy sometimes too much time. And, you know, a lot of people have said, hey, shouldn't you be coming out against this guy and things? And I'm like, well, you know, I'm just still kind of trying to see what's going on there. Again, you know, I'm very careful who I recommend anymore because so many are turning, you know, and falling apart. So I really, you know, I'm getting ahead of myself about who I can recommend, but, you know, learn from many witnesses. Just make sure that they are following Paul's example, that there are some aspects of Paul in their ministries. And I'm going to go over those here in a couple minutes here. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 19. This is an interesting verse. Actually, we'll go up to verse 18. For first of all, when ye come together in the church, I hear that there be divisions among you, and I partly believe it. For there must be also heresies among you, look at this, that they which are approved may be made manifest among you. There will be heresies among the body of Christ. Why? So God can show who's approved. So then those guys that are approved are perfect and they never make mistakes, right? No, of course not. Everybody's going to be off in something. I mean, you're never going to find a perfect Bible preacher. You know, I love when I see in the comments people say, you know, you've been a great blessing to me, Brother Brian, and I thank you for that. Don't agree with you 100%. Well, praise the Lord. Proves you got a mind of your own. I don't want a following of Denlingerites or something. You know, although that charge is coming out more and more now. So... you know, maybe we'll form a club, we'll get special t-shirts and hats and things, and it'll be really exciting, you know. I'm kidding. Don't start getting things prepared there, so. Just had to put that in there. But you see the thing in here, that there will be heresies among you, that they which are approved may be made manifest among you. And you're going to see that more and more as time goes by. More heresies coming in, and those who are approved, those who are straight in their doctrine, aren't going to fall for it. And those are the ones that you mark them and you say, okay, I'm going to follow that one. I'm going to follow their ministry because they follow Paul. Paul follows Christ. Now, let's look at some of the qualifications. Very interesting here. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. What are the qualifications to be a minister of Christ? Obviously, you need to have at least a PhD, preferably a THD and a THM, and an honorary doctorate. And wrong. Let's look at the qualifications here. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. You see, when you start to have to brag on yourself, when you have to start to actually give your qualifications, you're speaking as a fool. All right. Sometimes you have to do it. And whenever I do it, I'm not bragging. I'm not saying, look at me, I've read all of these books. You know, and I get that thing too. It's so funny. You know, I'll say, you know, I don't have any university education. I don't have any degrees. And people say, how knoweth this man letters, having never learned? You know, they'll put that on me like they put on the Lord. They perceive that I'm an unlearned and ignorant man, just a country hillbilly, logger, you know, a wood turner, you know, woodsman. And now I'm a preacher, so, you know, who are you? And I say, okay, but I've read all these books here, you know, and a lot of this stuff in it. And then they say, oh, you know, much learning doth make thee mad. You know, I'm a Ruckmanite because I've read a lot and I've studied a lot and things. And I get people, get all worked up and stuff. Oh, you're trying to make yourself look intelligent standing in front of all these books. No, it's just a very handy place for me to be able to do videos where I can turn around and say, okay, let me show you this book here or whatever. But sometimes you have to speak as a fool. Sometimes you have to give your qualifications, and it's not that I'm bragging out of pride. It's just I'm stating facts. I'm not just a YouTube little youth, junkie or something like this that gets on and runs his mouth like, in front of does Camtasia videos about how the Illuminati sacrifices people or something like this, like. This little vigilant Christian guy, he's got like 300,000 some subscribers, and I saw he's with, saying stuff on Moon Ann's channel and stuff too. People take the guy seriously. A bunch of little punks that haven't studied the Bible, and they're coming out and they're going to teach you the scriptures. And of course, he's post-trib. All these guys, I studied, I really studied, I really researched, and now I'm post-trib. I've returned to the historic position of the church. Yeah, you have. Sure. You haven't studied. If you're saved, the Lord will not lead you into post-trib rapture belief. Okay? If you got there because you're listening to false prophets. You didn't get it from here. Unless you're non-dispensational, you haven't learned it yet. But let's continue. Verse 23. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more. In labors more abundant, in stripes above measures. Above measure, in prisons more frequent, in deaths oft. In other words, his life was, almost to the point of death. I can personally attest to that. There have been a couple times where I've been, had a foot in the grave almost with my health issues and whatever else. I've had a couple close calls with death. I had a very, very bad ATV accident this past summer. And I came out of it with some scrapes and bruises and everything. No broken bones. And it was easily, I could have been killed in the thing, and it was doing work, by the way, so don't think I was just fooling around and acting stupid on the thing or something. It wasn't. But, and I've had some close calls too, by the way, when it comes to ministry stuff, so that too. 24, of the Jews, five times received I 40 stripes, save one. They were beating him. Thrice was I beaten with rods. Once was I stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck. A night and a day I have been in the deep. In journeyings often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils by mine own countrymen, the Jews. In perils by the heathen, the Gentiles. In perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness. In perils in the sea, and I always love this one. In perils among false brethren. Hello, I got that one. I got that one good. In weariness and painfulness. In watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness. Beside those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. Who is weak and I am not weak? Who is offended and I burn not? If I must needs glory, I will glory of the things which concern mine infirmities. The God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is blessed forevermore, knoweth that I lie not. Okay, then he goes on to talk about escaping from the governor there in Damascus. But you see this thing there of when you are doing right, you're going to get kicked around, you're going to get persecuted and things. Now, I cannot say I qualify for all those things that Paul went through there. Okay, I haven't been imprisoned yet. I haven't been beaten with rods or anything like that. But many of the other things I have, I can attest to those. But you don't see this thing there of it's just all about your education or whatever else. Or being ordained or something like this. But go next to 1 Corinthians chapter 4. We were here earlier, but we're going to read again. Actually above the verses where we previously were. Starting in verse 10. 1 Corinthians 4 verse 10. We are fools for Christ's sake, but ye are wise in Christ. We are weak, but ye are strong. We are ye are honorable, but we are despised. Even unto this present hour we both hunger and thirst, and are naked and are buffeted, and have no certain dwelling place. Again, I've been through a lot of that. And labor, working with our own hands, been through that. Being reviled, we bless. Being persecuted, we suffer it. Being defamed, we entreat. We are made as the filth of the world, and are the offscouring of all things unto this day. I write not these things to shame you, but as my beloved sons, I warn you. If you're newly saved, you are going to go through some hard times. That's just the way it is. You say, well, I thought, you know, salvation was going to give me an easy life. No, salvation gives you eternity in heaven. You don't go to hell and burn forever. And, you know, you get through a lot of these things. Don't think that the Lord's just going to, you know, allow you to be down here just getting just beat from pillar to post all the time. You're never going to have a good time. You're never going to be blessed of God. You'll find that a lot of times when you go through a rough time, God will bless you afterwards. You'll go through some times where it's just like you're really, really sick and you just, people are mocking you and whatever else. And you get through the thing and it's just like you have some great blessing that comes from the Lord. You'll see that. So don't get discouraged. Don't think to yourself that, boy, you know, I thought Christianity was going to be much better than this. And I'm just really, you know, my friends are turning against me. Everybody's turning against me. I feel alone. It'll all be worth it. Okay, the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us, says in another place. But I just want to make a comment here. Verse 13. Verse 12. Being reviled, we bless. Being persecuted, we suffer it. Okay. I know that there's somebody out there probably writing right now that I have been rebuking different false prophets and I block people from the channel and things like that. Well, I put up with a lot, right? But there is a certain point in time when I just simply say, okay, this guy needs to be rebuked. He's a false prophet. We're going to see about that as we continue here. But I do allow a lot. I suffer a lot of persecution, right? I go through a lot of it and I allow it. Again, I'm not going to go out there and just, you know, get rid of anybody that disagrees with me. You know, there's been many times I've learned from disagreements. But, you know, what people are seeing a lot of times when I get very angry, the last thing there was the Moonan study, which I'm taking down as when this video comes out. He was rebuked publicly, and that's all I need to do. He's in God's hands now. It's out of my hands. But that video there was after 2 years of just kind of seeing what's going on here and things and kind of seeing some, I don't like the way this is going, knowing the whole time that his wife was part of the Department of Defense. And again, I got some stuff on that. People, you know, got upset with that. You know, he wrote you a private note and you published it. Well, you know, if somebody writes me a private note saying, hey, you know, my wife works for the Jesuits and don't tell anybody. Well, you know, and I start seeing them bringing out Jesuit-inspired videos, yeah, okay. I don't owe you any kind of allegiance, any kind of respect at that point. You are an enemy. And Gunan and his wife are enemies of, you know, the truth. Going post-trib, well, I don't think he was going post-trib. I think he's always been. And some of the other stuff and things, a lot of the Jesuitical stuff that they're coming out with, it's going to be exposed. Just as simple as that. And you say, well, yeah, but you should have handled it differently and stuff. Have you ever read Matthew chapter 23? You know, I mean, do you think that the Lord, when he was rebuking the Pharisees and things and yelling at them, do you think he was just doing it in a nice, soft, effeminate kind of a voice? Now, I know a lot of you got it. You know, a lot of you were like, amen, brother, keep it going. You know, thank you. Thank you. I appreciate the fact that you understand my spirit. Okay. I do put up with a lot. And I have put up with a lot, and I will continue to put up with things, but I have to also remember that I have a fold. The Lord has put me into the position of a pastor. Again, I struggled with that. You know, what's really my role here with the body of Christ? Well, it's becoming very clear that he has me to oversee a flock of people. And I take that as a great responsibility. Again, I don't believe in a sole pastor type of a position. And I thank the Lord that there are some older Christian, both men and women, in the comment section that kind of answer people's questions. You're kind of like elders in the church. Again, you know, is this the perfect situation, the YouTube channel and everything else? No, it's not. You know, but it's what we have right now. It's how we can get the word out as quickly as possible and change a lot of people, get people saved. So I really appreciate you if you're an older Christian. Even if you're a newer Christian that's really on fire for the Lord, please get down in those comments and answer people's questions. I can't do it. I mean, again, I have to say that. We get letters. I had to shut the email thing down a while ago because it was just, it gets to the point of just absurd. I mean, I'm getting hundreds of emails. I can't answer them all. I just can't put the kind of time into the studies that need to be done to answer people and things. I used to spend, 2, 3, 4 hours answering one email, real, real detailed and stuff like that. I can't do that. So, and people ask me very, very detailed questions. So I'm like, I'm still, another thing I need to say, I'm still trying to work out this thing of is there a way that I can divide up responsibilities with the ministry? A brother, I'm not going to say his name, but a brother down south takes care of the sermon audio website. I don't even have to do anything with that. I mean, he takes care of everything, and I thank the Lord for that. There's a lot of brothers. I have a brother over in Australia that's setting up a website that actually has all of my videos on it that's not YouTube, and just kind of as a backup in case this YouTube channel gets taken down. There's other people that are mirroring the videos. That's all helping me, And as far as my wife is concerned, she has her own research projects, and she is extremely thorough with her research, with what she does for the Lord. And again, she feels the same responsibility that I do. We don't want to just get out there and just make a bunch of claims that aren't backed up by research. But the problem is research takes time. So she's working on some very, very in-depth stuff right now, which I'm not going to mention, but, we're doing what we can to try and answer people. And then you throw into things just a regular life and whatever else. It's very busy. And so again, what did Paul say? Paul said about the care of all the churches, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. Well, each group of you out there, you are your own little churches, your own little Lego building blocks, so to speak, that we can click together and form the church. And when the rapture happens, when Jesus catches us up and we get to be, finally the body of Christ will all connect at that point in time, that's going to be the first time ever that the church is going to be one, right there. And I'm looking forward to it. Can't wait for the rapture. But finally, let's go to one more place. Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20, beginning in verse 28. And again, this is a verse that's really becoming more and more true for me. And if you're an older Christian, it's very true for you as well. Verse 28, take heed, therefore, unto yourselves. In other words, don't think that, the Lord showed me a lot of different things over the years, and I have, a good amount of understanding. Again, I have to speak foolishly for a minute, but I have to take heed to myself. I could fall just as easily as anybody else. You see? Take heed, therefore, unto yourselves and to all the flock, over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers. Not your seminary, you see? Not your university degree. The Holy Ghost hath made you overseers. God will confirm those who are truly His, and they'll come out with truth. That's another reason why I try not to look at the comments, but it's like I want to look sometimes because I'm going, some of you come up with comments and I'm just like, wow, I never knew that. I learned from you. It's great. It's great to have that fellowship of the Spirit that I see among the body of Christ. There have been many times I've been tempted to just go and shut down the comments, but I need to see those comments, some of them comments. And then I get the poison of the false prophets coming in there too, which kind of irritates me. But continuing, which the Holy Ghost hath made you over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God. That's what I'm trying to do right now. Which he hath purchased with his own blood. Again, another scripture proving that it was God's blood that was shed on the cross. Contrary to what John MacArthur says. Verse 29. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Interesting. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after them. Now that's in the first century. That doesn't happen anymore today, right? Wrong. Very, very much today. Verse 31, therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I ceased not to warn everyone night and day with tears. I have no choice but to rebuke false prophets. He say, well, why? I don't understand. If I am overseeing a flock that God has put into my trust, and the flock is saying, hey, brother, could you please do a study on this? I don't really understand that. Could you answer this question? Could you answer that question? And while I'm doing these studies and while I'm trying to answer people's questions, I still have FAQ, you know, videos I need to get back to. I mean, it's just crazy. And I'm trying to get these things together and stuff like this, and all of a sudden I see a wolf pop up. And that wolf comes in, not sparing the flock, and they're going, hey, what about this? And hey, what about that? And they're putting all these doubts in people's minds, and the people are going, I don't know what to think about that. I'm kind of confused now. And I have seen it. I have seen where wolves come up and they will literally destroy members of the flock and draw them away. They speak perverse things to draw away disciples after them. Ed Fenninger with his easy believism stuff. Kevin Zacher, another guy that's attacked me quite a bit. He's a just wing nut. You know, Brian Moonan here recently. Kent Hovind. Again, he's really trying to, I mean, he's just coming out in his pride, attacking those of us that teach the pre-time of Jacob's trouble catching away. A lot of these guys, they're just coming out and coming out and coming out, you know, and some of them I used to recommend. Now it's just like, I can't recommend them anymore. You know, it's quite disgusting. But, you know, it's kind of like, I don't know if you remember, you know, got to use an example from my childhood here. But I used to watch the Looney Tunes, you know, and they had this they had different, you know, things, different characters in the cartoon. And one of them was the sheepdog. And this wolf was always trying to get up into the flock, always trying to get there into the, you know, flock of sheep there. And, you know, he'd sneak in and he'd have some little plan and stuff, you know, and he'd go and he'd be grabbing sheep and pulling them in underneath the sheepskin that he had over his back. And all of a sudden, you know, he's going like this with his hand and he goes, and he grabs this big leg. And he goes, and looks up, and it's the sheepdog. And the sheepdog looks down at him, and he goes, bam, you know, and pounds the guy on the head, or, you know, the wolf on the head, boom, you know, or something like that. Well, I'm the sheepdog, okay? I'm sort of an under-shepherd underneath the Lord, underneath his leading. And if, you know, brother, just feed the sheep. Brother, feed the sheep. Don't worry about the wolves. I can't do that. I'm not going to consume myself with, you know, going out hunting wolves or anything. But when they start to come in against the flock, Martin Richling, another one, you know, Steven Anderson, when they start to come after the flock and try to kill members of the flock, I have to do something about the wolves. I can't just say, ah, never mind the wolf. I'm just going to keep feeding the sheep and feeding the sheep and feeding the sheep. Oh, the wolf killed another one. Well, you know, I'll get to that sometime. Here you go. Food, food, food. Oh, wolf's killing more people. I have to do something about the wolves. And a lot of times, I'll try to gently rebuke somebody that I perceive to be a wolf. And I see what they do. You know, I did a very gentle rebuke on Kent Hovind on his stupid book that he came out with. And a lot of people have been rebuking Kent Hovind. And in his pride, he's just like, I'm charging forward with this heresy. He has no desire to repent. So, I'm taking the gloves off with Kent Hovind. He's very, very false. And someday I'd like to confront him personally on this whole issue. We'll see what the Lord does. You say, well, then what chance do we have? What can we do? Verse 32. And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified. There you have it. What I have to do, you know, I actually met a brother here locally. I went to an auto parts store, and if you're watching, high, you know. But I went into an auto parts store down in Holton, and I walk in, and this brother's like, "I know who you are, you know. I know who this is. I know who you are. Or I know who this is. I forget." And you know, I'm thinking to myself, like, you know, kind of like, "Oh, you're talking to me," you know. And he's like, "You know, you're Brother Brian Nendlinger." And I was like, "Yeah." I was like, "Do you know Matt?" He's like, "Yeah, King James Video Ministries." And you know, we started talking, and it was a real blessing to talk to him, talk to a brother like that. And we got on the subject, and he said, "Let me ask you a question." He said, "Who can you recommend as far as listening to?" And I said, "Well, brother," I said, "the book, King James Bible. And if somebody preaches from it, listen to them. And if they're right, good. If not, don't listen to them." And that's really all I can do. I mean, I cannot endorse ministries anymore because it's just getting to the point where so many have fallen away. And it's only going to get worse. But I saw again one of your comments. One of you said, you know, the darker it's getting, you know, the dark are getting darker. But as that happens, we get brighter. Our light that shines, Jesus Christ shining through us, it's going to get brighter and brighter as time goes by. And all those things, all the teachers and things like that that have tried to say, you know, whatever about the King James Bible is not a good translation. Well, they're starting to see it now. Why? There's so many rotten ones. You know, this conspiracy stuff, one world government conspiracy stuff is nonsense and blah, blah, blah. Oh, actually, you're seeing it now. Where the King James Bible, when it says back in Revelation 13 about the mark being in the hand or in the forehead, that's ridiculous. You know, it has to be on and not in. Oh, yeah, actually, you're seeing it now. The implantable microchip, all the stuff that's going on with that. The closer we get to the catching away of the body of Christ, the more right we're going to be. And I'll tell you what, we're seeing a real separation right now between the truly saved and the lost, the professing Christians out there. And I've been having a lot of grace for a lot of people because I want to see people get saved. I want to see people, you know, I want to be able to recommend other people. But, you know, the separation is happening. We are in the falling away. All right. So, wanted to put this study together. Don't fall for this lie that you're going to hear. Like I said, the most recent one I heard was Brian Moynihan said it, you know, that you should follow Christ. Don't follow man. Don't follow man. And he's following men. He's following Sam Adams and other false teachers and things like that. Somebody, you come along and you say, you know, I appreciate some of Dr. Ruckman's stuff. I learned some things. Appreciate Sam Gipp, you know, down in here. And so, I appreciate so-and-so, and I appreciate, and somebody goes, "Oh, you're following men." Well, as long as they're following Paul's example, I'm supposed to mark them which walk to have them as an ensample. That's what I'm supposed to do. So don't let them confuse you. Don't let them bring you down. All right. It's just nonsense. So I guess that's going to be it for this study. I'm going to be currently finishing up another study right now on pre-trib rapture scriptures in the book of 1 Corinthians. And it's not just going to be chapter 15, verses 51 through 58. There's a lot of stuff in there that is definitely proving that Christians go out before the time of Jacob's trouble, before what people would call the tribulation, which is a false term. Been over that before. But our blessed hope is there, and it is something that we can look forward to. The body of Christ, when we go to be with the Lord, we're literally going to be one at that point in time. And then you're going to get up there and you're going to see who was saved, those that followed Paul's example. And you know, that was one of the things that actually convinced me of, that I was not saved back at when I got saved when I was 25 years old. You know, I started to study things and I started to read the Bible and I started to think, you know what, my life really does not line up with what I'm reading in this book. I really can't say I have a lot of these experiences. And I wasn't following Paul's example. And you know, and anybody's example really in the Bible. I was living pretty wickedly. I was a moral person, but I really didn't have much relatability to the book. And I got saved, came to the Lord, and I said, boy, I don't know, Lord. I mean, I'd prayed a prayer of salvation when I was 8, and I just simply said, I don't know if that did anything. I need to know. I need to know that I'm saved. And I was sick and tired of the world. I was sick and tired of sin. I just was like, you know what? I don't care about anything. I just need to know that I'm saved. And I got down on my knees, and I stayed on my knees until I knew. And it was a couple hours that I prayed to the Lord until I knew for sure that I was saved. And you say, well, wow, then you never sinned after that? Oh, brother. No, I still struggled with sin. And you know something? I still struggle with sin. I've never taught sinless perfection. But I could see the change. Something happened. All of a sudden, family members that used to think I was great and everything else and got along with, all of a sudden we stopped getting along quite the same way. All of a sudden, friends that used to like to hang out with me didn't want to hang out with me anymore. All of a sudden, my interests and likes and hobbies changed. Things changed. Why? Well, the Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Your life will change. It definitely will. And one of the accusations that will be brought up, as I've said, is that you're following men. Don't fall for it. So that is going to be it for this study. Again, as always, please keep us in your prayers. Thank you to all those who donate to the ministry. That keeps us going. We are in this thing for the long haul. I'll tell you that. I have, like I said, I've struggled with this thing, and what does the Lord really want? I've never been one to just say, you know, I'm just going to push my way into ministry, and I'm just going to do whatever I have to do to stay in ministry. And as far as I'm going to, if I have to compromise, I'll compromise. If there's a truth that's bothering people, then I'll change so I don't offend. So I, you know, tiptoe through the tithers. No, no. That's never been this ministry, and that never will be this ministry. I'm going to tell the truth. It's not going to make me too many friends, I realize, but those friends that are out there that I have, I praise the Lord for you. You're the ones that count. You're the ones that keep me going. So that is going to be it. Thank you very much for watching.